What I would like to do today is cover a pretty vast field. We can get into definite details and specifics in the responses in the Q&A discussion session afterwards. But right now, what I'd like to do is kind of cover three major areas of new developments in this area of maybe a God and physics that have been covered by people like Alexander Vilenkin, Alan Guth, and of course, on the opposite side of the question, Stephen Hawking and Leonard Mlodinow. I'm just going to go through five areas today. First, I really do need to give a little caveat on the horizons and parameters of natural science, just so we get an idea of what can science do, what can't it do, as we kind of move into this new evidence. Secondly, I'd like to take a look at, as Brian suggested, the space-time geometry proofs. Secondly, new developments in this whole area of entropy. Thirdly, take a look at some of the fine-tuning arguments, their strengths and their weaknesses in light of the multiverse and other possible hypotheses for explaining them. And then finally, just reach some conclusions after taking a look at the contemporary theories of the multiverse to see where that stands relative to an explanation that has divine intelligence. Let's take a look first at the area of horizons and parameters of science. What about science? The first thing that probably will occur to you is, can science actually disprove God? There are a couple of people who have been suggesting this in contemporary media, and quite frankly, that's just not possible. Disproving something is much more difficult than proving something, especially if, like you must in science, use some form of empirical or observational evidence. And here's the reason. Let's get outside of the context of God for a moment and take aliens. So if you would like to prove the existence of an alien, all you need to do is observe one, and that will do the trick. Disproving aliens by means of observation is much more difficult. You would literally have to go throughout the entire universe and try to observe everything that there was to observe, because after all, observational evidence is particular. It's relegated to specific space-time points. It is not like a prioristic evidence where you can take a look at universal laws or principles. So you have to make observations, concrete observations. To try and disprove something with this method will require looking for the aliens everywhere, and then making sure, of course, that they haven't run away once you've gotten to the planet at hand. Making sure that you have the capacity to observe, truly observe, everything that there is to observe so that they're intrinsically observable by you. And then finally, notice that they are not there. This is tough. Now, when you get to God, it's even worse, because God transcends the universe. And quite frankly, up to this point, we have not been able to get beyond our observational event horizon, even to a multiverse, let alone an entity which transcends even multiverses and transcends physical reality itself. To say then that you can disprove God by observational evidence, which is truly what natural science and physics is stuck with, it's a very, very difficult prospect. Secondly, it has been contended that if you can't disprove God from physics, then how can anybody say that there's evidence for God from physics, for God from physics? And of course, the answer is you don't have to observe everything that there is to observe in order to notice that it isn't there. What you have to notice is that there is some kind of a limit, an intrinsic limit, not necessarily to the spatiality of the universe or the mass of the universe, which may in fact be there, but just a limit to pass time in the universe, or a limit to pass time in a hypothetical multiverse in which we might be immersed. Can such a proof, can such observational evidence constructed in a proof lead to this awareness of a limit to past time? And the answer is yes, because that limit is intrinsic to the universe. It is, as it were, in the universe. It doesn't transcend the universe. It's not beyond the universe. And so you have the very peculiar thought that you can actually find not only a limit to our universe, but even a limit to a hypothetical multiverse, which we'll talk about in just a moment, which actually can show this limit to past time, that there must be, in some sense, a transcendent, I'm going to call it causative force, beyond our space-time asymmetry, and even beyond multiversal space-time asymmetries, which will, in fact, at least give a clue, evidence for, not necessarily a proof, but evidence for the existence of God, a transcendent being. Now, what can't science do? Science cannot come to a definitive proof, as you might be able to do in metaphysics or logic. It simply cannot. Science is an inductive discipline. As all of you who have been in philosophy of science 101 know, it moves from particulars to theories, generalizations, and universals. The particulars, as I just said, are observational particulars. They're data which must come to us by means of some form of direct observation or measurement, experimental test, or some other means of garnering it from particulars in what we'll call the observable world. Now, what does that mean? That means that every conclusion that I say today must have a caveat attached to it. The caveat is that something may be discovered in the future, quite honestly, which could negate the Bordovilenkin and Guth theorem. Could. You just don't know. Because science must completely be open to new discoveries, to new particulars, to new observational data, which could actually affect any particular theory that we have. As I'll be talking about today, the key thing to notice, though, is that you can have rigorously established theories. Those rigorously established theories, in turn, will have a minimal number of conditions attached to them, and they will have a vast general applicability. And those features are good. That makes for a good scientific proof or a good scientific conclusion or a good scientific theory. However, on the other hand, could there be a new discovery that could change the theory, that could affect the proof? The answer is absolutely yes. And because of that, we must remain open to the fact that any conclusion which I draw today may have an explanation beyond a transcendent cause, even a naturalistic explanation, which, of course, we don't know simply because of an insufficiency of data. Nevertheless, the evidence is compelling. It is probabilistic. And so we'll talk about the kind of conclusion that we want to get. Just one last point before I kind of proceed. There's been a lot of talk in the popular media, and Stephen Hawking has kind of given rise to this in many ways with Leonard Mlodinow in their new book, The Grand Design. I don't think they meant to say it this way, but of course they have been popularly interpreted this way, that science can sort of discover everything about everything. That science can have a, quote, theory about everything, such that scientists can be certain that there is no need for God anymore. There is no need for a transcendent cause because science has done all the explanations. To be very frank with you, this is simply not a possible enterprise for science. Because science is an inductive enterprise, because it moves from particulars to generalizations to theories to universals, because it must always remain open to new discoveries, it is impossible for a scientist to authentically claim that they know everything about everything. My gosh, they can't even know everything about everything in the physical universe. Something could be discovered tomorrow. And certainly, when Stephen says, and he's obviously an incredibly intelligent person, but he is overstepping the bounds of methodology when he claims that string theory is that everything about everything which science has discovered. You know, I have a lot of friends who are stringers. They're great guys. But every single one of them admits to me, we don't yet have any empirical evidence for string theory, let alone saying that string theory is the theory of everything about everything. That claim is simply too bold. It is too bold, and in most good theorists will admit it immediately. We must remember, science is inductive. Because of its link to particular observations, it must remain open to new discoveries, and claims about knowing everything about everything are simply, well, they're just not possible. So, with those four caveats in mind, with those four methodological considerations in mind, we can proceed carefully to three exciting areas of contemporary Big Bang cosmology and space-time geometry. I'm not going to go into the history of this too thoroughly, but what I'd like you to just know is that, you know, religious people have been on the cutting edge of these theories for a long, long time. And of course, Father Georges Lemaître is now widely acknowledged to be the father of the Big Bang theory. I know that many people think it was Hubble and Humason, but actually there is very good scholarly work that has been done just in the last year, which shows that Lemaître's paper and Lemaître's constant actually preceded Hubble's paper and Hubble's constant by 3 years. Hubble's constant is more accurate than Lemaître's constant. He had better observational data. But the Big Bang theory was in fact fathered by Father Georges Lemaître, Belgian priest, studied at MIT, colleague of Hubble's, colleague of Einstein's, and of course, very much at the forefront of our contemporary cosmological theories. By the way, Hubble was very much aware of Lemaître's paper. And of course, those of you who know space-time theory very well have heard of the Lemaître constant. You've heard of the Lemaître, you know, Walker transformations. You've heard of Lemaître, Walker, you know, space-time and so forth and so on. All of these things are very much interlinked with people who brought faith and science together. There are many other instances of it in the 20th century, including many of my brother Jesuits who have been involved, certainly, in observational astronomy for many, many years. In order to kind of give you a sense of some of this, this Majus Institute, which is on that website, www.majusreasonfaith.org, which I had up there at the very beginning, if you just go to that, you can get this. And in fact, there's lots of these in the back. But it's just eight physicists who many of you will know. You know, Dr. Arno Penzias, who received the Nobel Prize for discovering the background radiation of the Big Bang, and John Polkinghorne, you know, the Cambridge particle physicist who became an Anglican priest, and a bunch of other people, Lisa Randall's here, Jennifer Weissman, and and Michael Heller and Owen Gingrich and a bunch of other physicists, just put them together to talk about, you know, the evidence for God from physics, looking at both the kind of a historical side, but also at the evidentiary side, which I'm talking about today. But let's proceed right now to what's exciting, what's going on in contemporary cosmology. First, space-time geometry proofs, then taking a look at entropy, and then finally at fine-tuning arguments. Space-time geometry proofs, and here's where you can actually see why I have that caveat at the very beginning. It's because there have a space-time geometry proof. Let me just talk about that for just one moment. As most of you know who are familiar with the general theory of relativity of Einstein, space-time is not an empty void. Space is not, for example, a vacuum. Space is not even a Euclidean geometrical context for the interaction of energy. Space-time is a highly dynamic, quote-unquote, field in and of itself. It can actually change the nature of energy's manifestation. It can actually cause changes not only in trajectory, it can actually change, well, the size and even the mass density of the manifestation of energy. Space-time has all kinds of dynamics. It has all kinds of properties. And of course, it actually does affect mass energy. Mass energy affects it. So there's kind of an organic unity between the space-time field and mass energy fields. And that, in turn, is what gives rise to this organic unity of physics and the general theory of relativity that's so spectacular. A second quick thing about space-time, and then we can get to the matter of space-time geometry proofs again. As most of you know, when Lemaître and later Hubble and Humason actually formulated the theory of the Big Bang, they did not imply in any way that there was, as it were, galactic systems and galaxies moving away from each other in an already existing space-time field. Instead, what they postulated, what Lemaître almost preposterously postulated, was that space-time itself was expanding. Excuse me, I'm just getting over a little bit of a hoarse throat. Too much talking. But that space-time itself was expanding. In other words, that the spatial field was expanding and taking the galaxies, as it were, along with it. And so what you'll notice then is that you don't have this, as it were, pre-existing space. You literally have growing space, and the growing space, almost like a balloon, right? As you blow up the balloon, if you have dots all over the balloon, right? As you notice, when you expand, if you consider the space to be, as it were, or consider the balloon, the elastic of the balloon to be like space, as the space expands, as the elastic of the balloon expands, then you notice that two, the dots all move away from each other so that nothing is moving from a particular central source. Space is expanding and pulling everything away from everything, such that there's really no real center of our universe. Instead, everything is at the center, and everything is not at the center, because everything, as it were, is kind of equally being pulled away from everything else within that expanding spatial system. Now, with these two things in mind, the organic unity between mass energy and space-time, and the expansion of space itself, right, causing the expansion of the universe, you can actually make proofs. You can actually show that there has to be a beginning of that space-time. The first proof was actually put forth by Stephen Hawking himself in conjunction with Roger Penrose in what was then called the Hawking-Penrose singularity theorem. By the way, theorem is more like proof. Okay, so when you hear that word theorem, you know, think of it more or less like a proof. Whereas you hear the word theory, think of that more or less as kind of the best way of putting everything together, right? It's not necessarily a proof per se. It's just the best way of putting everything together that we know of so far. So the key idea then is a space-time geometry theorem is like a space-time geometry proof. Okay, now the key idea was, when Hawking and Penrose postulated this, they really had no idea about an inflationary universe. And then Alan Guth came along, who is the father of inflationary theory, an American astronomer at MIT, who is responsible for one of these space-time geometry proofs. Alan Guth came along and discovered inflation. Well, once he discovered inflation, it violated the third condition of the Hawking-Penrose proof. Once that was violated, right, and inflation, by the way, is caused by vacuum energy. Vacuum energy kind of works the opposite way of regular energy in its interaction with gravity, and because of that, for all intents and purposes, we can see that a condition was violated in the Hawking-Penrose proof, and that proof went by the wayside. So it was a proof for the beginning of a universe, the proof for a singularity. And a singularity, by the way, is a very important thing to recognize, because what it means is a point not only at which the universe and its mass energy comes into being, it is the point at which space-time comes into being. A point at which physical time comes into being. Why is this so important? It's important because if physical time is coming into being, if physical time didn't exist previously, then there is nothing of physical significance that can occur prior to the singularity. In other words, physical reality and its space and time, physical reality itself was nothing. Physical time didn't exist. It was nothing. There was no before. There's no physical before. Now, there could be a metaphysical time or a metaphysical before, but a before or a time continuum attached to physical reality didn't exist. This is important. Why is it important? Why did it cause such consternation early on in physics? It causes that consternation precisely because if physical reality was nothing, and you really treat nothing seriously, right? And Stephen and I got into it, right, on the Larry King show. You can't call nothing a low energy condition of a false vacuum fluctuation. That still is something. It's still something. You can't call nothing the law of gravitation. Even if you have a platonic, disembodied, non-physical, mentative law of gravitation, it's still something. And it even begs the question of a mind to have that thought. The point, though, is, and we must insist on this, that nothing is nothing. Parmenides' old point, nothing is nothing, and there is no such thing as nothing. We can't sneak some something into nothing. If physical reality was really nothing, then we have to contend with this bizarre fact. Because the only thing that nothing can do is nothing. Now, this is a real problem. Because if nothing can only do nothing, then when physical reality was nothing, it could not have moved itself from nothing to something, because it could only do nothing. This is the problem. So when physical reality is nothing, and it can only do nothing, and it can't move itself from nothing to something, you know the implication already, which Stephen Hawking, at his own birthday party, admitted this year. Gosh, it has transcendent implications. No kidding. Something else would have had to have done it. Something else would have had to have moved it from nothing to something when it was nothing. This is the problem. And that's why when we deal with the space-time geometry proof, we deal with a singularity theorem or a singularity proof, what you're dealing with is something extraordinary. It is an absolute limit to physical reality. Well, as I already just implied, we know already that when we say that physical reality was nothing, we can say, well, we better be pretty definitive about this, and Stephen Hawking's proof failed. The third condition of the Hawking-Penrose singularity failed. And so for a while, it seemed like space-time geometry proofs were out of favor, until in 1993, Arvind Borda and Alexander Vilenkin, Arvind Borda is an Indian physicist over at the Kavli Institute at the University of California, Santa Barbara, and Alexander Vilenkin is the director of the Institute of Cosmology at Tufts University in Boston. The two of them got together and made a whole new space-time geometry proof. But this time, it was in light of inflationary theory. So in other words, they worked around the third condition of Hawking's proof and then showed that every inflationary universe or multiverse, which met five conditions, would have to have a kind of absolute beginning, a singularity that we're just talking about, would have to have a singularity. It would have to be what we call past-time incomplete. It would have to have a beginning of its time. In fact, physical reality would have to have a beginning. The problem with this proof was it had, like Hawking and Penrose's proof, it had five conditions. And so you can imagine what took place from there. With five conditions, of course, the third condition, once again, I don't know, the jinx third condition, a loophole was found. Now, it was not a huge loophole. It was called the weak energy condition loophole, but it was a way you could kind of wiggle out of it. The odds, of course, of having this loophole were about 10 raised to the 10 raised to the 43 to 1 against for our universe, or a multiverse to which our universe could be connected, like in an eternal inflationary scenario, which I'll describe in a moment. But the key thought, of course, is, for all intents and purposes, right, it did offer a possibility. Now, Alan Guth, who was the father of inflationary theory, who holds the high chair of cosmology there right now at MIT, he came along and he said, you know, this condition is so remote, I do not consider it to be of any importance whatsoever, this exception. So he said, I don't care about the weak energy exception. I still think that the Borda Vilenkin 1993 proof is a very good proof. It still establishes a singularity of any universe or multiverse that meets the five conditions which our universe or multiverses to which our universe could be attached to. It seems to meet all these conditions. It seems that you have to have a beginning. Before I proceed to what Alan Guth talks about in his 1999 example, let me just kind of give you a quick sense of what a multiverse is so I don't confuse you entirely. When inflationary theory came about, and Andre Lind, promoted this, what we notice is that it did give a possibility of explaining fine-tuning theories that we'll talk about, and also the possibility of averting a beginning of our universe. at the time that Linde is proposing it, basically we see that the Board of Hellenkin proof has already had a huge effect in the cosmological community. And because of that, there is a kind of a need to establish that there might be some possible other alternative. Our universe really looked like it needed a beginning. And it needed a beginning irrespective of the Big Bang. So let me just kind of go through the outline for just a second of a few of the theories that were postulated to avert the Big Bang being the beginning of the universe. As most of you know, 13.7 billion years ago, plus or minus 200 million years, the universe came into what we'll call its contemporary general relativistic form in a Big Bang, right, which really wasn't a bang. It was actually an inflationary moment that gave rise to a tremendous expansion, which eventually gave rise to a whole bunch of energy emerging. But 13.7 billion years ago, essentially, you have this emergence of our universe in its contemporary form described by general theory of relativity. Now, the question remains, was that the beginning of the universe? Many, many physicists still believe that it is. They simply do. They don't think there's anything prior to it, and there's no evidence that there was anything prior to it. However, there is, because of inflationary theory, and also because of string theory, there is a possibility that there could be a prior universe. One such possibility is called a multiverse, or let's just stick with our universe for a second. There could be a prior period in our own universe, okay? So there might be some period that existed in some kind of a prior state, okay? Prior to the Big Bang, and then suddenly the Big Bang occurred from this prior, maybe quantum cosmological state, a cosmic egg state. Also, secondly, there was the multiverse theory, that somehow our universe is but one bubble universe amidst trillions upon trillions upon trillions of other bubble universes in a huge mega universe called a multiverse. Okay? And of course, the multiverse in the false vacuum fluctuation is kind of coughing out bubble universes hither and yon. Our universe is but one of them. But you can see that the multiverse hypothesis could, even if we had a beginning of our universe, whether at the Big Bang or some prior period, right, you could avert maybe a beginning of a multiverse and therefore avert the possibility of physical reality having a beginning. And that's a very real possibility in physics. Could happen. There's no proof of it, but it's a possibility. Thirdly, you have what's called new string theoretical oscillating universes in higher dimensional space. What's an oscillating universe? Oscillating universe would be, for example, from our Big Bang on, of course, we've had only an expansion. And there's so much dark energy in our universe, right? 72.6% of our universe is dark energy. Dark energy is not like dark matter, Dark matter actually is pulling things together. It's interacting with gravity in the standard way. Okay, dark energy is just the opposite. It's like a field attached to the space-time field, and it's literally causing a repulsive force. It's causing space-time to expand and expand very rapidly. Okay, well, right now we have such a high propensity of dark energy in our universe, it's pretty clear our universe is going to continue expanding. And it's going to keep expanding until we get to thermodynamic equilibrium. We'll talk about that in a moment. But for the time being, though, let's suppose that the dark energy, we could get rid of it. Okay? I don't know if you can or not without a deus ex machina, but let's suppose you can. Then there could be a prior period, right? If the dark energy didn't exist, maybe the universe had a prior expansion. And then because there was an absence of dark energy, you had a contraction. And then maybe before that, another expansion and contraction. Another expansion, contraction, so forth and so on. And maybe those things went on ad infinitum. Well, when we get to entropy, we'll talk about why that possibility really doesn't exist anymore. And even a very atheistic physicists like Sean Carroll deny a bouncing universe altogether. But we'll talk about that in a minute when we get to entropy. The key thing to remember right now is it offers a possibility. So you had these string theory, higher dimensional space universes, like two three-dimensional membranes sandwiched between four-dimensional space-time bulk, and they could kind of collide against each other in the four-dimensional space-time bulk and burp out kind of a new universe and a new cycle in higher dimensional space-time. And so you didn't have to worry about the entropy problems and everything else. You could kind of burp these things out indefinitely. Now, very highly theoretical, but maybe that offers a possibility. So three possibilities of getting out of the Big Bang being the beginning of the universe. And remember, a beginning is a real problem in physics. Number one, you could have a multiverse. You could have a prior period of our universe. Number two, you could have a multiverse. Number three, you could have a bouncing universe in higher dimensional space-time of string theory. Okay. Now, those three possibilities presented so many options that all the way until 1993, a lot of people just said, you can't talk about a beginning of the universe anymore. It's almost a silly kind of a prospect, right? Don't talk about it. There's just too many other options. But starting in 1993, things didn't look so good anymore in terms of just options. Because notice that the 1993 five-condition proof of Borda-Vilenkin actually applied to multiverses as well as to universes. The reason we know this is because all multiverses must be inflationary. You cannot have a multiverse without inflation. And having that inflationary component enables you to make a proof about the multiverse just as easily as you can make a proof about this universe. And so we see in 1993 that the first of such proofs is made with the weak energy condition exception, the weak energy condition loophole, which is a very rare possible loophole, but a loophole nevertheless. Then Alan Guth came along in 1999. As I said, he is the father of inflationary theory as the chair of cosmology there at MIT. And he came along and he did a series of models. So he took every present model and then extrapolated all other kinds of possible models from our present models of inflationary universes. And he made this kind of astounding discovery. He noted, so far, every single model that we have been able to generate or extrapolate appears to require a beginning. All such inflationary models can be eternal into the future, but they cannot be eternal into the past. They must have a beginning. So now you have Guth's modeling combined with the Borda-Vilenkin proof, which in some senses both apply to multiverses as well as to our universe. Now, in 2003, the three of them get together and they make a remarkably elegant proof. And it's called the Borda-Vilenkin-Guth proof or the Borda-Vilenkin-Guth theorem. And in the Borda-Vilenkin-Guth theorem, there is only one condition. Only one condition. And this is very important because a single condition proof is much more difficult to undo or disprove than a five condition proof, obviously, right? Five condition proof got many open flanks there. But the single condition proof, here's the interesting thing, is completely irrespective of the physical properties of the universe or multiverse it is describing. So the physical properties, right? It doesn't matter whether our universe is a general theory of relativity universe or not, or the multiverse operates according to GTR or doesn't operate according to GTR, or has quantum properties like our universe does, or quantum property. It doesn't matter. It's completely irrespective of the physical properties of the universe, except one, that the average Hubble expansion be greater than zero. By the way, a Hubble expansion, it's like a Lemaître expansion, it just refers to the expansion rate of the universe as a whole. The expansion rate of the universe as a whole. Remember when I was talking about space expanding and pulling all the galaxies away from all the other galaxies? So it refers to the expansion rate, this extra space, the stretching of space that's taking place, which is pulling, or of the universe as a whole, which is pulling the galaxies away from the other galaxies. Okay, now, in view of that fact, okay, so in view of the fact that we have this average Hubble expansion, why is this such an important proof? Because our universe is in fact inflationary. It must meet the condition of an average Hubble expansion being greater than zero. By the way, it doesn't matter how small the expansion is. The expansion rate is, you know, it doesn't matter how small, just, you know, minimally greater than zero, it fulfills the condition of the proof. Okay? Our universe certainly fulfills that condition, and so must every multiverse, because every multiverse must be inflationary. How did they do it? Here's the non-mathematical answer. By the way, if you want a math answer to this, you're interested in it, Alexander Vilenkin's got a great YouTube lecture that he presented at Stephen Hawking's birthday party at the beginning of this year. By the way, it's a very astounding lecture. He titled it, Why Physicists Can't Avoid a Creation. And Lisa Grossman, who was covering it for the New York Times and the New Scientist, if you want, just send me your emails and I'll send you the link to the New Scientist and to the Alexander Vilenkin links. But she titles it, Why Physicists Can't Avoid a Creation, : the worst birthday present ever. Anyway, if you want the math explanation, Alexander Vilenkin gives a very, very fine lecture for anyone. If you've got some basic calculus, you will see how this works mathematically. But there is a perfectly logical explanation, which both Guth and Vilenkin give, which I think you can see the essential properties of it. Imagine for a moment that because of the stretching of time, let's just take some round figures. Let's just say that a galaxy, a distant galaxy from me, is moving away from me at 200 million miles per hour. Now, if you know anything about the Lemaître or Hubble constants, the further away you get, so a galaxy that's further away is actually moving away from me faster than one closer to me. Why is that? Because there's more space between galaxies, as it were, right? There's more space between the more distant one and the less distant one. And that more space, it's expanding too. So you got the space between me and the near galaxy plus the space that's between the near galaxy and the far galaxy, right? And so you've got two spaces, as it were, expanding. So it's going to be receding. The more distant one will be receding faster from me and so forth. You sort of get it? Okay, now, let's suppose you have a rocket ship. And the rocket ship, instead of going 200 million miles per hour, is really going, let's say, 800 million miles per hour. Bring in whatever you want. Now, what is its relative velocity as it approaches the near galaxy? So it's traveling to the near galaxy at 800 million miles per hour relative to me. But remember, that galaxy is moving away from the rocket at 200 million miles per hour. What's its relative velocity relative to the near galaxy? 600 million miles per hour. 800 million minus 200 million, right? So notice then, let's go to a further galaxy, one way out there. And because of the extra space, let's say it's twice as far away, it's traveling at 400 million miles away from our rocket ship, 400 million miles per hour away from our rocket ship, away from us. That rocket ship traveling at 800 million miles per hour, what's its relative velocity compared to the further galaxy? 400 million miles per hour. So we say then that as the rocket ship is going into the future, right, because we can just translate that greater distance into future time, right, because it's going to take us more time to get out there. So as we move into the future, relative velocities are all doing what? Slowing down. That's right. Have they been doing this since the Big Bang? Absolutely. All relative velocities, because of the expansion of space, will have to slow down as you move into the future. Our rocket ships or our light, we'll talk about light in a moment, but any other moving projectile will be slowing down. Okay. Now, what does that mean? Let's go back into the past for just a moment. Going back into the past. What were all relative velocities doing? They were had to have been faster, correct. So if they all had to have been faster, then we're going to get to a point at which all relative velocities are going to hit what we call maximum velocity, which in our universe, what's the maximum possible velocity for physical energy transfer? Speed of light. Eventually, it will become arbitrarily close to the speed of light, at which point, you can't go back any further. You have literally hit a beginning. That's correct. Now, could there have been a multiverse? Could this beginning just be the beginning, as it were, of our universe? Yeah. And could maybe we be in a multiverse, which also itself? Yep. But what would happen to all those universes that had relative velocities within that multiverse? What would be happening to their relative velocities going into the future? Slowing down. And therefore, their relative velocities going back into the past would have been faster, until they got arbitrarily close to a maximum possible velocity. Now you might object, well, maybe in the multiverse the speed of light isn't the highest possible velocity. True, that could be. And in other universes, maybe there's other constants. Who knows? But we know one thing, there has to be a highest possible velocity. Otherwise, you don't have any space. You see, you get into two big paradoxes if you've got infinite velocities of physical energy transfer. The first one is, if just imagine now, we've got physical energy and it can go at an infinite velocity. This must mean one of two consequences. Either it's everywhere, so it's like at multiple spaces. No, it's almost like at a gazillion different places all at the same time. Because remember, it's everywhere. Or you reduce space to nothing. You get your pick. Now, either pick is bad. And there's a lot of physical consequences for it. But pick number one is bad for the obvious reason that if everything is sitting there at infinite velocity, then everything is everywhere. And this makes for a vast number of contradictions. So we call this the universal contradiction paradox. So we got an electromagnetic field combined impossibly with a graviton field combined with something else, all at the same place, because everything is everywhere. So you go, no. Everything is not everywhere. Well, if everything is not everywhere when physical energy is all going at an infinite velocity, then I got a question for you. Where is it? Well, you reduce space to nothing. And we know we need one thing in order to have a multiverse or a universe. We need some space. So we can safely say that there is going to be some form of maximum velocity of physical energy transfer to avoid universal contradictions in the disappearance of space. Does it have to be the speed of light? No. For all I know, they could discover tachyon tomorrow. I don't care. The point, of course, is it doesn't invalidate anything. All that the BVG theorem says is that relative velocities in inflationary or any universe that has an average Hubble expansion greater than zero, no matter how small, relative velocities will always be slowing down into the future, which means it's always going to be coming right back to a maximum velocity in the past. When it hits that maximum velocity in the past, arbitrarily close to that maximum velocity, you are at the beginning of that entity. What does that mean? You can have multiverses, within universes of universes. But we know one thing about every one of the multiverses of the universes. They're all expanding. They all have average Hubble expansions greater than zero. And that's why Alexander Vilenkin confidently declared at the birthday party the following. It is said that a good argument will convince a reasonable man. And it is also said that a proof will convince even an unreasonable one. Now that the proof is in place, cosmologists can no longer hide behind the possibility of a past eternal universe. He negates the possibility of it when the average Hubble expansion is greater than zero. There is no escape, he said. The cosmologists must now consider the reality of a beginning. This is a bold assertion. He also states very conclusively in his book, Many Worlds in One, he makes the conclusion very clear that there has to be a beginning of any universe which has an average Hubble expansion greater than zero, and this must apply to all multiverses. Excuse me. When the proof was written up in 2003 in Physical Review Letters, which is an important journal of physics, it was not only applied to all multiverses, it was also applied to all string theoretical universes in higher dimensions, including those with three-dimensional membranes sandwiched between four-dimensional bulk spacetimes, and a variety of other rather bizarre string theoretical hypotheses. The point is, this thing has vast universal applicability. It's not dependent upon the physics of a particular universe or multiverse, even in higher dimensions of string theory. It only has one condition, that the average expansion of the universe or multiverse as a whole be greater than zero, no matter how small. That is an interesting thought. And we should, with all the caveats mentioned at the beginning, it should give us pause. Because, as at least Guth says, probabilistic persuasion begins to move in favor of a beginning from the physical evidence. It's interesting. Probabilistic. Something new could be discovered. Something could undermine it. Here's the state of things today. Secondly, if you don't mind, I'll just quickly go to entropy. I know I used up a lot of time on that. I do want to get to your questions. By the way, if you want a summary of this, it's in the chapter one of this book. But also, if you want the Vilenkin, I'll send you the link. Go to my email is spitzer@modus.us or spitzer@modusreasonfaith.org. Easier to remember modusreasonfaith.org because that's our website. And I'll send you all the links to Vilenkin. Secondly, entropy. As many of you know, entropy is a measure of the movement, the irreversible movement of systems of energy from an ordered to a disordered state. Think of an ordered state. Well, let's just take an ice cube and a puddle and hot water. You'll notice that when ice cubes melt into a puddle, they don't spontaneously reappear as ice cubes again unless you freeze them, unless you put something into the system. You'll notice that as systems move from a boiling state to a cool state, they don't spontaneously become boiling states again unless you heat them and you put some energy into the system. Think of a disordered state like this. Think of it like that puddle. Think that you can mix that puddle any way you want. And at the end of all the blending and mixing, it is essentially the same as when you started. Think of that as high entropy. High entropy means quite disordered. Okay? Think of low entropy, on the other hand, as being ordered so that it has some kind of distinctness within the system, which when you mix a low entropy system, like an ice cube, right? So you melt the ice cube or you grind the ice cube or whatever, but you melt it, right? You break down the order of it. It doesn't come out the same way after the mixing or the melting, or the cooling in the case of the hot coffee. It actually just stays melted unless you put more energy into the system. So what's said is, in isolated systems, so you're not putting something new into them, there is an irreversible process from an ordered state to a disordered state. There's an irreversible process of being in a specialized state to going into a kind of randomly distributed state, which randomly distributed state will always appear the same after a mixing as before it. Now think further that randomly distributed, disordered states can't do very much work because they don't have any internal differentiation within them. They can't do very much. Right? Cosmic background radiation from the Big Bang, perfect example of a very high entropy, that is to say, very disordered state, right? Very randomly distributed state. If you take a cosmic background radiation, quite frankly, you can wish that it will do things, but it can't. It has no internally distinct properties that can interact with each other, which can cause some work energy to be done. And so, quite frankly, it's not going to do anything. It's kind of dead. Let's call it a dead system of energy. Can't do much. Now, of course, you probably get the general argument already. Well, if entropy is an irreversible process, that is to say, if we're always moving from ordered states to disordered states in isolated system every time work is done, if that's the case, then if time, and, oh, by the way, a star is a low entropy system, right? Or a whole galaxy of stars is a very low entropy system. High order, right? And we'll see in the Big Bang, it's a high order, very low entropy system. Okay. Now, here's the thing. If you begin with even low entropy, and there is an irreversible process over time of that low entropy becoming high entropy, then, of course, if the universe had been around for an infinite amount of time, everything would be at maximum entropy today, which means everything would be like cosmic background radiation and the universe as a whole, as an isolated system, would be effectively dead. Now, a lot of people tried to come up with various ways of getting around this. And there are three major ways in which this can occur, but let me give you the two problems of entropy right from the beginning. The first problem of entropy is that it does imply a beginning if the because the universe could not be infinite in time and still have low entropy today. Our universe is a very low entropy universe today. So we are not anywhere near optimal, anywhere near maximum entropy in our universe. Not anywhere near it. And that's a curious thing. It seems to portend not only against an infinite universe, but an infinitely bouncing universe. In fact, it doesn't even seem, if you combine the evidence for dark energy in our universe with the energy a low entropy of our universe today, it doesn't seem that there was even one bounce, let alone multiple bounces. And the second problem of low entropy is it's highly improbable. Low entropy, right, putting something into a very ordered, organized, finely tuned configuration so that it can do work like a star, right, with multiple interacting systems, right, or the precursors to a galaxy, or even the smooth expansion out of gravitation. All these things require exceedingly low entropy. And Roger Penrose decided to calculate one day, well, what are the odds of this low entropy occurring at our Big Bang by pure chance, giving rise to what was called the Penrose number? He calculated, right, by the way, it's a very simple calculation for math buffs. All you need to do is take the total amount of entropy in our universe, and right, we know that there are 10 to the 80 baryons in our universe. You multiply it by the entropy per baryon, which is 10 to the 43, and that gives you 10 to the 123. That's the total entropy of our universe. And the total amount of phase space possibilities for that amount of entropy is just the exponential of 10 to the 123. So what is it? What are the odds against our universe having been a low entropy universe? 10 raised to the 10 raised to the 123 to 1 against. That's a double exponent. Let's think about that for just one moment. That's like a 10, and then in the exponent you have a 1 with 123 zeros after it. Let's think about that. So the exponent now, the exponent is a trillion, 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 trillion. In the exponent. If you tried to put that into zeros, with each zero being 10-point type, our solar system would not hold it, would not hold that number. That's like saying, I'm going to give a monkey a stern order. Type the corpus of Shakespeare in 2 weeks by random tapping of the keys. The monkey begins furiously typing, and lo and behold, you come back in 2 weeks, Macbeth, by random tapping. Hamlet, Richard III. You think to yourself, wow, this is highly improbable. And indeed it is. And you think, perhaps someone with a good knowledge of Shakespeare might have helped the monkey rather than use the random tapping explanation. Well, that's what we're dealing with today. Then, of course, people thought, well, maybe you get a rebounce. But so, first of all, you get the point. You got two big problems. How in the world can you explain low entropy at the beginning of our universe by pure chance? The answer is, it's very difficult. We'll talk about Sean Carroll in just a moment. At the end of the day, though, you really can't. It's just exceedingly too improbable. It's like taking a proton and saying, am I going to take my proton dart and I'm going to hit this other red proton out there somewhere in the whole Milky Way. And you throw it, and lo and behold, it hits it. What are the odds? Okay. The point is clear. How can we get around these two problems? low entropy at the beginning, how do we get around the problem of can't go back indefinitely? Some people thought that maybe a bouncing universe would give us additional tries, so that with each bounce you get a start over, as it were, so that you got high entropy, high entropy. After 10 to the 10 to the 123 bounces, one day, poof, our universe came out with low entropy by pure chance because I got all those bounces. You see what I'm saying? Sort of. But that doesn't work. And Sean Carroll himself, right, the very guy who proposed the whole atheism, he just says, that's not really how it works. Because you see, with each bounce, you'd have to start all over again from scratch. And the second problem is, going back into time, every single expansion causes higher and higher entropy. So each prior universe would have had to have had lower entropy at the Big Bang than ours. And he says, it's just absolutely absurd to even think of it that way. Furthermore, what everybody discovered, Roger Penrose and Jacob Bekenstein in their equations, basically discovered that as the universe goes into collapse, its entropy increases by a factor of 10 to the 80th. So universal collapses don't get you out of anything. And in point of fact, they just increase the improbability of the universe actually being able to exist. So where do we stand? Sean Carroll is the only one who's tried to respond to this. And Sean Carroll basically has the multiverse hypothesis as his kind of backup explanation. If you can't explain low entropy at a bounce, and you can't explain the low entropy of our universe at a bounce, if you can't explain it just by it reoccurred by pure chance, well, perhaps with the multiverse, if the multiverse itself had very low entropy, I mean very high entropy, and it never increased, so all you needed to create all these bubble universes in the multiverse was basically a kind of a medium entropy, you know, that never decreased. It could be like a perpetual motion machine. You could actually generate bubble universe after bubble universe without ever increasing the entropy of the multiverse. And then even though every single bubble universe would be subject to entropy, and it eventually would die and go into heat death, the multiverse itself would not go into heat death. But in order to do that, you've got a real problem. You've got to make a very specialized multiverse. And in order to make that very specialized multiverse, you have to put a whole lot of laws and properties into the initial conditions and constants of the multiverse so they can fit the, you know, the perpetual motion machine concept of Sean Carroll, which means you need a lot of meta fine-tuning. So you get out of the problem of fine-tuning and entropy of the multiverse, and instead you put the fine-tuning problem right back in and all the meta fine-tuning that you have to put into the initial conditions and constants of the multiverse to get it to be a perpetual motion machine. What's the difference? Just move it back one step. The entropy arguments are still probative. They're probative for multiverses because, remember, entropy does not depend upon the specific physical characteristics of the thermodynamic system. Entropy is a statistical. It is a statistical law. It just so happens to apply to thermodynamics. It happens to apply to statistical mechanics. But it is statistical. Frankly, the odds of having order, you know, spring out of disorder are much, much more highly improbable than disorder springing out of order. I mean, it just comes, it's like billiard balls, right? You take the cue ball, you hit the finely ordered rack of billiard balls. They scatter all over the place. You say, no big deal. Disorder out of order. I'm used to it. But if you hit the cue ball at the 10 ball, which hit the 8 ball, which hit the 7th ball, and it went back into the triangular fine-tuned formulation and spit the cue ball out at the end, you go, whoa, that's weird. In the same way, honestly, entropy is a statistic. It's like the puddle. You stir it, and of course, you know, if you have a disordered system, you'd expect it to go right back to its disordered state. But you'd be really shocked if it went back into an ice cube without introducing something into the system, et cetera. You get the point. So the entropy arguments today are still quite probative. They're probative for a beginning, and they're probative for fine-tuning. If I could just have 5 more minutes to just go into the fine-tuning things, then I'll just sum it up. Fine-tuning is the third area that we really need to deal with. It's by far the most controversial area. Honestly, besides Sean Carroll and a few other people, people are not attacking entropy arguments. They're very strong. And by the way, the number of real attacks against the space-time geometry argument, the space-time geometry proof of Bordov, Lincoln, and Guth, very rare. Very rare. I mean, you have a couple of guys trying to make time's arrow go in reverse and special De Sitter configurations of imaginary space and blah, 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 that are physically unrealistic, but nobody takes them seriously. These fine-tuning arguments, people, they're controversial, but they're interesting, and I bring them up because they're one part of this whole system of evidence that kind of all starts pointing to the same conclusion. I'm going to stick in a caveat, realizing that if the Higgsian field does decay in a certain way, you could get some supersymmetries that would explain some fine-tuning in our universe. So I picked 4 examples that are really kind of impervious to the supersymmetry kinds of things that might happen in the decay of a Higgsian field. But maybe, you know, maybe those can be explained too, you know, so I put a caveat in it. But for all intents and purposes right now, these fine-tuning arguments are very valid arguments, and, you know, you might want to just take a look at it. Fine-tuning arguments, well, one of them you've already seen. 10 to the 10 to the 123 to 1 against low entropy in our universe. That takes exceeding amounts of fine-tuning in order for that universe to occur. Doesn't seem like it would do that by means of pure chance. But there's all kinds of other fine-tuning arguments on the basis of universal constants as well. There are 20 major universal constants in our universe. The Hubble constant you've just heard of, right? The speed of light constant we just talked about. 300,000 kilometers per second, 186,200 miles per second. Planck's constant, which most of you have heard about. Those of you who took physics 101, the gravitational constant. In fact, all 4 of our forces have constants, right? So we have 4 forces in our universe. We have the gravitational force. It has a constant. We have the strong nuclear force, which binds protons together in the nucleus of an atom. It has a strong nuclear force coupling constant. Weak force, which causes radioactivity and nuclear particle decay, right? It has a weak force constant. And then, of course, the electromagnetic constants, which you're all used to, right? You have the mass of a proton, the mass of an electron, the electromagnetic charge. So you've got these 20 constants. And remember, a constant is a number. And that number, in turn, right, it actually controls all the laws of physics. So it actually, these numbers control all the ways in which energy interaction occur and the interaction between space-time and energy occurs. So these numbers are highly, highly, highly important. Here's the problem with those numbers. If they varied ever so slightly from their values, and by the way, they could have had any value at the Big Bang, within certain general parameters, but they're really general parameters. Higher or lower, then our universe would be inhospitable to life. Any form of life. This is the bizarre thing. For example, just as an example, if you just take 2 of those constants, the gravitational force constant and the weak force constant, right? You vary them by 1 part in 10 to the 50. That's a decimal point with 49 zeros and a 1. Very small fraction. Higher or lower from their current value. This is astonishing. Then either the universe would have, in its expansion, been continuously exploding, which, by the way, is very bad for life forms. All life forms. Don't want them incinerated, right? Or the universe would have collapsed into a black hole where the entire mass density of the universe has collapsed into 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, which is a decimal point with 32 zeros and a 1. It's a really small amount of space, right? and 10 to the minus 33 centimeters with everything being crushed forever, which is equally bad for life forms. You get the point. This is a really small margin of error. One part in 10 to the 50. Let's suppose we don't get a supersymmetry explanation for this. This should give you pause. Are you kidding me? You think this happened by pure chance? Number two, strong nuclear force coupling constant. Make that puppy 2% higher. There's no hydrogen. This is very bad for life forms. And no nuclear fuel, no water, etc. You make that puppy 2% lower, and for all intents and purposes, there's no element heavier than hydrogen, which is very bad for life forms. Okay, just a couple more and you get the point. Just vary the gravitational constant, right? One part in 10 to the 39, higher or lower. Vary the electromagnetic force, charge constant, or the mass of the proton compared to the mass of the electron. One part in 10 to the 39, higher or lower. Then every star in our universe would either be a blue giant or every star would be a red dwarf. Now you say, I've never heard of a blue giant star before. Luckily, that's because we don't have many. Because if every star in our universe were a blue giant, everything would be incinerated. And if every star in our universe were a red dwarf, they'd all be frozen. Both equally bad for life forms. The list goes on, and you can read about them in the book or, you know, go on the website and free encyclopedia. What's my point? A one-time pure chance explanation of low entropy at the Big Bang, a one-time pure chance explanation of the gravitational force and weak force having their parameters within one part in 10 to the 50, strong nuclear force within a parameter of 2%, higher or lower, of the electromagnetic charge and the mass of the proton compared to the mass of the electron or the gravitational force, one part in 10 to the 39th. You get the point. Are you kidding me? Again, just not possible to explain by a single chance observation. The multiverse is really the only naturalistic explanation that can avert some form of design in the universe. Either that or a supersymmetry which can explain everything. Which, by the way, that's a pretty remote possibility, but that's another matter for another day. The point, of course, is with the multiverse, two thoughts should occur. Number one, every current multiverse hypothesis, aside from the fact that they're all untestable, right? And aside from the fact that you have to postulate trillions upon trillions upon trillions of other universes in order to explain just one, ours, right? That's kind of a violation of Occam's razor. Prescinding from all that, every single one of them requires just huge amounts of fine-tuning. What do I mean by that? What we mean by meta-fine-tuning is, instead of having the fine-tuning in our universe, what you have now is meta-fine-tuning in the multiverse. We talked about it and we saw that just when we were talking about Sean Carroll's hypothesis that the multiverse could explain away the entropy problem. But in order to get your multiverse to explain away the entropy problem and get basically a perpetual motion machine in the multiverse, in order to get the universe just to have the bubbles, the bubble universe is not bouncing into each other. You don't want bubble universes bouncing into each other. Very bad for life forms because the entire space-time coordinate system of that universe is wiggling like a jello. And this is very bad for what we call consistent properties and complexification, which is required for life and evolution. So you've got to make sure the bubbles don't bounce. Got to make sure that it's a low entropy perpetual motion machine, et cetera, et cetera. Well, by the time you do all that, you got to have, and Albagetti and Life have, you know, you can look at all the footnotes in here. They have postulated, they went ahead and took a look at the probability of all this meta-fine tuning happening by pure chance. And you know what? It's pretty darn similar to what we're dealing with in trying to explain the constants of our universe alone. All we wound up doing is moving the fine-tuning paradox back one step. And that should give us pause. My conclusion. The multiverse hypothesis is still a hypothesis. It still can exist. There's still the possibility of a multiverse. But now we see two things. That multiverse must have a beginning. And furthermore, it looks like it needs to be meta-fine-tuned as much as our universe, or at least seemingly as much as our universe. And in light of all of these things, the beginning of even multiverses, of string theory, higher dimensional space universes, when we combine the three different data sets, we see something utterly fascinating beginning to occur. John Henry Newman was cardinal in the Catholic Church, but he had a wonderful theory in his book, The Grammar of Assent, called informal inference. And what he meant by that is when you combine data sets from, you take three very different data sets that, depend on three different kinds of observational data, and you look at the rigorously established theories that come from those data sets, and if they all point to the same conclusion, both mathematically and logically point to the same conclusion, right, observationally, right? He says, at least you can say from the vantage point of the convergence of antecedent probabilities of these individual data sets that you are coming to a more probabilistic conclusion, a more rigorously established conclusion. And today, the exciting thing in physics is you really do have all three sets of data. The space-time geometry proofs, now with a single condition proof that doesn't depend on the physics of the universe and of course applies to multiverses and string theoretical oscillating universes, and you have entropy, that still to this very day applies even more rigorously to the universe and the multiverse than it did before, or at least implies metafine tuning on the part of the universe. When you combine that even with all of the strange anthropic coincidences that constitute at least some indication of possible cosmic design in light of the fine-tuning of the multiverse, the requirement for fine-tuning of the multiverse as well as a beginning of the multiverse, when you combine these things together, they do seem to lead to an informal inference. Could this change? Yes. But a change, the minute you get an informal inference from three different data sets, even if there is a radical or significant change in one of the data sets, there still could be adjustments that are made within that particular theory that could form the coincidence with the other two data sets, which leave the rigorously established conclusion on the basis of three data sets intact. So the key thought at the end of the day is, what do we have? I would say, we have some kind of a probabilistic conclusion that points to a beginning, which beginning actually is a beginning of physical reality, which does imply some transcendent cause outside of physical reality, because the beginning of physical reality is a beginning of physical time, which means that prior to that state, there's literally physically nothing. Physically, there's nothing. Of course, there's God or transcendent reality or whatever there is that's causing the occurrence to happen of a creation. But that's one thought. It seems to be evident in entropy, seems to be evident in the space-time geometry proofs. And then the design of the universe, with the low entropy of the universe being as it is, and with the multiverse hypothesis requiring fine-tuning, with the constants of our universe being what they are, there seems to be at least enough evidence for reasonable and responsible belief, as Guth would say, on the basis of physical evidence, to begin to think perhaps there is an intelligent, transcendent cause of it all. Thank you very, very much. Okay.
With a reflection on our topic is Father Michael J. Dodds, OP, Professor of Philosophy and Theology at the Dominican School of Philosophy and Theology, and member of the core doctoral faculty of the Graduate Theological Union here in Berkeley. Please join me in greeting our own Father Michael Dodds.
Well, Well, I'll try to be brief here. I really have just two thoughts. One is a thought about something, and the other is a thought about nothing. So thinking about something, I wonder why the atheist scientists that are publishing so much these days are able to think what they think and say what they say and pretend that they are saying it from a scientific perspective. And what I believe is that they are not doing science at that point, but they are into a kind of ideology of scientism. They have a fundamental mistake of thinking that the method of science, this mathematical method, which is so productive, is not just one way to look at the world, but is the only way. And another more serious mistake they make, I think, is to think that beyond the things that this method can think of, there is simply nothing to think of at all. Now, how can they think that? Well, because they've taken their method and turned it into a metaphysics. Instead of saying, I want to look at the world in terms of measurement, and I'll only look at the world in terms of things I can measure, they say, only things that I can measure exist. So things that are not measurable cannot have being. And when one makes that move, then one tends to think that God is one of the things that cannot exist. If only what is measurable is real, and only material things are measurable, then God must be unreal, since God is neither material nor measurable. QED. So I think the answer to that approach is to point out that this is not an argument from science, but an argument from an ideology of scientism. So much for something, now for nothing. Father Spitzer wants to get us to nothing through his arguments. He argues at the beginning of the cosmos, which science discovers in the Big Bang, is an absolute beginning, a point prior to which there is no physical reality. But one has to ask, I think, whether science, in keeping with the limitations of its method, can reach an absolute beginning or only a qualified beginning, a beginning of the universe insofar as it can be known and studied by current science. So in other words, can science show us that the moment of the Big Bang, which represents the beginning of our universe insofar as science can study it, a scientific question, is also the moment of the first instantiation of created material being, a metaphysical or theological question. If someone were to ask me, do you disagree with anything in Father Spitzer's talk, I'd have to say I don't agree with anything, but I do have a little bit of a disagreement with nothing. That is, have we gotten there or not? Does the Big Bang really get us to the beginning of created reality? Pope Pius XII thought it did. He wrote once that it would seem that present-day science, with a sweeping step back across millions of centuries, has succeeded in bearing witness to that primordial fiat lux, let there be light. The beginning of the universe that science discovers is the absolute beginning. But is that the case? The Pope also later said that such arguments are outside the proper sphere of natural sciences. And the Jesuit astrophysicist William Steger comes to a similar conclusion. He writes, the origins with which science can deal are always what we might call relative origins, which are indeed very important, absolutely crucial for us to understand, but they are not absolute, ultimate origins. So I agree with Father Spitzer that we get to a point where we are indicating a beginning. We have to ask ourselves, what are the implications of that beginning? And only one thing to take into consideration when we talk about that beginning is to remember that this is a beginning insofar as science can speak of a beginning, and that might be distinct from the beginning that we posit, either metaphysically or in terms of our confession of the beginning of the world in the act of the Creator. Thanks.
Thank you, Father Michael. And moving right along to our next reflection, by Father Anselm Ramelow, Associate Professor of Philosophy and Chair of the Department of Philosophy here at DSPT, and member of the Core Doctoral Faculty of GTU. Now, without further ado, I present to you our own Father Anselm Ramelow.
Thank you very much. Father Spitzer has dealt in his talk with various arguments for the beginning of the universe and the fine-tuning of many of its constants and parameters. Arguments which would seem to imply that the universe originated with a spiritual and intelligent cause that would qualify as a creator god. He also argued against various ways in which scientists have attempted to explain away those things that would make the Big Bang dependent on such first transcendent, omnipotent, intelligent, efficient cause. What I now want to suggest is that even if those arguments against Father Spitzer would succeed, he still might win the argument. Father Spitzer's argument might still largely qualify, though, as arguments for a god of the gaps. In this case, the gap for an efficient causality of the universe as a whole, for example. And I don't mean that sort of pejoratively. I think such arguments are worth making. But they are, as he himself pointed out, typically vulnerable to empirical falsification. There could indeed be ways in which they can be explained away by alternative scientific theories or new empirical discoveries. As a backup, therefore, I suggest that we should look at what it means to explain something away. Any explanation appeals to something as an explanance. In this case, an atheist scientist might appeal to a yet unknown law of physics or a yet unobserved cause in the universe to provide the conditions in question. I would want to suggest that any such appeal itself presupposes what it wants to explain away, the need for a first cause of the universe. Unlike an argument from the gaps, such an argument is not postulating something in order to explain what is not yet explained by science. Rather, it shows that we need to explain what is already explained by science in order to explain why science can explain. The point is that science cannot explain itself, because the highest order laws of science are what science needs to use for the sake of explanation. But science cannot in turn explain what it uses to explain. And yet these highest order laws of the universe are not self-explanatory. They are not logically necessary, or something like the first principles of metaphysics. They are contingent, and therefore themselves in need of explanation. These highest order laws of the universe might be whatever current science tells us they are. It does not really ultimately matter. We might even abstract from the possibility to ground them in the nature and agency of the basic units and substances of the universe that an Aristotelian would want to consider. They will, in any case, constitute descriptive regularities as real features of the cosmos. They are what allows us to do science, develop laws of nature, be physicists. Without them, science would lose its subject matter as well as the ability to explain things, including explaining them away. It might be important to point out that these are not the fine-tuned constants of the universe that might point to a design, nor is this an appeal to regularity in the face of increasing deregulation by entropy. All of these presuppose more fundamental laws of the universe, if I understand that correctly. Likewise, it appears that we assume that the most basic and highest order laws hold across the various islands of the universe in a multiverse. Regardless of how such hypotheses about multiverses are conceived, the explanatory power works with the assumption that they make together for one cosmos, one reality in which they are connected. And this connection would imply one fundamental set of laws across all subuniverses, regardless of varying constants and the like. If it were otherwise, they would have nothing to do with each other and would not explain anything. And so my question is quite simple. Whence do such basic regularities across the universes arise? I do not think that we can just say that they are brute facts and that's it. Even the atheist physicist would agree with that. Otherwise, they would not develop unlikely scenarios like multiverses to explain certain unlikely regularities of various kinds. But not just certain fine-tuned regularities are unlikely, rather any regularity as such is unlikely. Chaos does not need an explanation. Regularity does. Nor is an appeal to chance an explanation, for chance is not a thing or a cause. Nor does even the concept of chance make any sense unless it is conceived on the background of regularity. Chance presupposes regularity, not vice versa. Therefore, chance cannot explain regularity. And therefore, we still are in need of a cause of this regularity. We need an explanation for the fact that we can explain things by way of these regularities. Furthermore, by the assumptions of physicists, this regularity applies across the whole of the physical reality, the entire cosmos. If that is so, then the cause of this regularity cannot again be in the cosmos. It cannot be just one cause among others, since such a cause orders all innerworldly causes among one another. Only an ultimate cause outside the cosmos can account for the regularity among all the causes in the cosmos. Perhaps someone might question the assumption that the laws of nature do in fact apply across the whole cosmos. I'm not sure that this is plausible. It is likely that the ontological coherence of the universe does require this. Typically, scientists would not question that coherence, at least on the level of the higher order laws of the universe. I would be interested to know whether there are positions that do in fact question this assumption. For my part, I would be inclined to think that this is something of an assumption, even if it would be otherwise unquestioned. For how do we know that these laws hold across the whole universe? Perhaps we might want to say that we can trace everything indeed back to a Big Bang in which everything was one and therefore has a uniform origin. But then how do we know that? After all, we know about the Big Bang only by already presupposing the uniformity of these laws, because only on that assumption can we trace contemporary evidence back to such an event. But this kind of presupposed regularity, which allows us to explain the universe in these terms, is indeed just that, presupposed. It's a mere claim, for no laboratory experiment can prove it. No empirical observation can provide the necessary evidence, because by definition, experiment and observation can give us only samples of reality, never reality as a whole. There is no such thing as a complete induction. In other words, we have to make a leap from empirical observation to the universal laws of nature. And this leap is a leap of faith, and it is a leap that is implied in the very procedures of science. Without it, its ability to explain would be in peril. There's one small final point. There's one more way in which science typically presupposes a leap of faith in its explanatory procedures. One more. That is this. Science typically favors the most simple and economic explanation in the universe. For example, Galileo's system was favored over that of Ptolemy, even though Ptolemy made reasonably accurate predictions for the observable data at that time. It was merely that Galileo was the simpler and more elegant explanation. But why would we assume that this is the truer explanation? Maybe the universe just is a very messy and inelegant place. Except, that is, if we presuppose that the world was formed and ordered by a supremely knowing and wise cause outside of the universe, a cause that is not only supremely intelligent, but also benevolent, such that we can assume that he created this world in the best and most efficient manner possible. I do not know whether there could be another way of doing science, but this is in fact the way which science accounts for its own explanatory power. If that is so, it needs to appeal to an intelligent and benevolent creator, even where it attempts to explain him away. Thank you.
We're right at noon here, but I think we do want to give the possibility for at least a few questions, if you're up to it, Father. And we would ask them to be directed at Father Spitzer, just because Father Anselm and Father Michael, we will have almost always with us, but Father Spitzer just today.
Good, thank you. And again, I apologize for going over and limiting these questions. And just in response to both responses were terrific. And I think they do bring out points which, because I stuck with the scientific presuppositions about which both respondents talked about, I didn't get into, but I think they are absolutely valid points. Just with respect to the one point about nothing, there is a kind of an interesting thing about singularity theorems, though, that if you can show that the singularity theorem actually does apply to a beginning of a multiverse, and you do have a kind of, a singularity theorem is called an absolute, the most fundamental state you can get in physics, right? Because all space-time points, lines converge into a single point. Because of that, there does seem to be at least some qualified evidence that there is nothing before it. But then again, I'd apply my own caveat to that. Something could be discovered which is more fundamental still. It's hard to see what it might be, but of course the possibility is there. And so my fine brother in Christ, Bill Steger, is quite correct in offering that good caveat and caution. But thank you both very much. I mean, those are extremely thoughtful responses. I wouldn't mind having them myself. Thank you. I would ask you, too, for your questions, if you could just go ahead and just shout it out to me. I have a little bit of macular degeneration coming on to me, so if I miss your hand, I don't want to miss it. So just shout out your question, and I would be glad to answer it.
Father, I have a couple of related questions.
Good.
So in particle physics, you usually, when you calculate things, you frequently run into infinities.
Yep.
But when that happens, you know, the reasonable conclusion is not that we actually get those infinities. We just know that there must be a theory at a higher energy scale that gets rid of those infinities. Right?
That
so it seems like that the same thing should also apply in cosmology, that when you run into an infinity, it's the reasonable conclusion is that there must be some other theory that regularizes things. So, and I think the second thing is we already know that general relativity breaks down below the Planck scale.
Yes.
So, don't we already know that the conclusions of the Vilenkin-Guth theorem won't apply, can't really be valid, because we know that it's an extension of general relativity beyond its domain of validity, right? So why would we trust the conclusions of the Vilenkin-Guth theorem? Because we know it, there must be something more.
Okay. Let me answer the second question first. Both, thank you very much, both good questions. The second question is because it doesn't depend on general relativity. In fact, Alexander Vilenkin and Alan Guth both say that this not only, that the conclusion not only does not assume any of the parameters of general theory of relativity, but that those parameters need not be assumed under any circumstance. So they already established it, and in the 2003 article, they very explicitly state that. Then after they state that, they show how it does in fact apply to quantum cosmology first. So quantum cosmology offers us a possibility of a pre-Big Bang state. And so that very possibility, they have to redress that. Remember, the only condition required is that an average Hubble expansion be greater than zero, independently of whether this is a quantum cosmological universe or whether it is some other kind of universe. Doesn't matter what it is. The second thing that they have to explicitly take care of is string theoretical universes in higher dimensions. So remember when I was talking about the three-dimensional membranes sandwiched between, interacting in a four-dimensional bulk space-time, all right, these kinds of scenarios. They do take four different kinds of scenarios of these higher-dimensional space universes to actually show that the BVG theorem or proof actually applies to all of them. So, the answer to your question very simply is it doesn't require any assumption of general relativity at all. It doesn't require even an assumption of string theory, nor does it require an assumption of quantum cosmology. All it requires is an average Hubble expansion greater than zero. With respect to the particle theory, you know, that's a really excellent thought. Could it be, you know, that we're just reducing to an infinity? Actually, that would be a very valid argument if, in fact, we were reducing to an infinity. The problem is we are reducing to a zero. And that is a very different thing than getting a parameter, right, that's an infinite parameter. It's going the opposite direction. When you're reducing to a zero point, and this is the problem that even Hawking had from the very beginning, when you move to a limit which is zero, it's very different because you honestly, if nothing is in fact the alternative to the zero point at the beginning, then you can't appeal to a higher system because that higher system would have to be real. And therein lies the huge problem. And it's the problem, by the way, which also Roger Penrose in 1989 in The Emperor's New Mind acknowledges. It's a very different thing to argue to an idealization of an infinity and then explain it in terms of a higher system, which is a very valid approach in particle theory. It's a very different thing to argue backward to not an ideal idealization of infinity, but to an actual limit prior to which there would be physical nothingness. And therein lies the difference, but both incredibly excellent questions.
Thank you very much for your talk, Father. In your talk, it struck me that there seems to be an analogy between your arguments and St. Anselm's proof for God's existence. Do you think, if that's the case, do you think that, and within assuming that Anselm, well, that there needs to be a further movement to the ascent of God, what do you think that movement is in your talk?
It is a little different from Anselm's arguments, actually, because Anselm's arguments were not based on empirical observations, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. That greater than which cannot be thought is an a prioristic move. Yes. Go ahead.
Let me just clarify that. I'm saying it's analogous. I recognize the difference.
Oh, okay.
The project is different.
Yeah.
But it seems that there's a leap, so to speak, with Anselm, that there needs to be a movement from the logical to the actual, or that there's a movement with Anselm from the logical to the actual. At least that's Aquinas' criticism, I think, if I understand it. I see your proof as like a dispositional proof, giving one disposing one to accept the existence of God, or limit, at least, of the universe.
Yeah, I would say that it's less of a dispositional proof in the sense that, you know, I offer this out as a possibility from a kind of a pure logic over to an actuality, because it isn't really a pure logic at all. It's a compendium of really three huge theoretical inductions from space-time geometry, from entropy, and from what we call fine-tuning of constants. So from that point of view, I wouldn't agree. On the other hand, it does offer only an openness and perhaps a probabilistic explanation, which could be complemented by our responses from today. But it does open the way from an empirical starting point to an openness to a transcendent explanation. And the openness at least has some probability attached to it. And it does have very real conditions attached to it, which are not unlike St. Thomas Aquinas' own proofs. So I do see a distinction between St. Anselm and these proofs.
Thank you.
There are two hands back here.
Sure.
Thank you, Father, for giving us a very nice informative lecture today. I really believe in the first point that science cannot disapprove God. In fact, science is proving the presence of God itself. I really agree with that point. And I have two questions. First, let's consider a bird in a, as a god. You know, if bird can light more than one egg at a time, is it possible that nature may have created multiple universe at the same time? If not, say, take an example. Is it possible that there will be this, instead of parallel universe, there will be the sequential universe, that the every universe may have its life, and after beginning of one, ending of one life of the universe, there will be the second birth of the second universe, like that. Is that a possibility?
It certainly is a possibility, and it's one that Alexander Vilenkin, this fellow I mentioned in the Board of Vilenkin Guth proof, the V and the VVG theorem, he takes it up in a very specific way and disproves its efficacy for getting around a beginning in a book called Many Universes in One, published in 2006. And he takes it up in real detail, but for the same reasons, essentially, that I sketched out today. Welcome.
We have these two more questions, and we'll leave it at that. Hi.
Thanks for your lecture. That was very interesting. I guess my question is, you brought up parallel universes possibly arising through inflation, possibly arising through string theory. But my question would be, what about those possibly arising through quantum mechanics on the many worlds interpretation? Because if that's true, you wouldn't have an absolute explanation, but given that the laws of quantum mechanics were in place, wouldn't that demand that all quantum mechanically possible universes, i.e. those that are compatible with the laws of quantum mechanics, would actually exist in the quantum mechanical multiverse, and given that those laws allow for life, that life would also then have to exist given those laws are in place?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, it's a good question. And I did leave them out today because I didn't move into the domain of quantum mechanics. I took on the cosmological explanation for the multiverse. But there is another kind of multiverse explanation, which is really a parallel universes explanation. It looks at the possibility that there can be what might be called branch universes or branches of branches which take place at every quantum choice that occur. Now, to be honest with you, these things are exceedingly controversial in physics today. And if you take a look at the bibliography in this book, where I do actually take up the quantum mechanical possibility of branch universes and parallel universes, you know, there are difficulties with the branches themselves. You know, do the branches themselves, because they are essentially in a unified state before the branching off, you know, in the quantum, quote-unquote, choice, do they have to leave a remnant of a universe behind them? Is there some way in which they must affect the universe from, you know, whence they came? And of course, David Boehm, if you are interested in this particular hypothesis, you may want to take a look at some articles that were written by David Boehm on this very possibility. In fact, Boehm and other physicists were writing about this way back in the 1960s, late 1960s. And in fact, if you want just a little argument, this guy, Paul Davies, wrote a popular book called The Ghost in the Atom, where he brought together some of the various theories of these things. That might be a place to start to see some of the paradoxes that are implied when you have branch universes that have no effect on the universe from whence it came, or that you have two completely different universes that are no longer linked to the stem universe. There are quantum problems associated with this. The second thing is the problem of, you know, a residue that, you know, would affect you know, the other. And the third problem that is postulated is this particular explanation of quantum mechanics preferable? In other words, is this really, do you have to postulate a whole other universe with the cat alive as well as the cat dead, if you're using the Schrodingerian example? Is this a preferable explanation
of quantum mechanical uncertainties and behaviors, or rather our contemporary theories of information systems and information fields a much more preferable explanation, which doesn't multiply the universe without leaving any residue or any relationship to a STEM universe. And so these are some of the problems that you get into. But the reason that a lot of physicists are preferring the cosmological one today of a multiverse rather than appealing to the quantum mechanical one, even Stephen Hawking in The Grand Design really doesn't appeal to it anymore, because it does have a lot of limitations. It has a lot of difficulties. There have been a lot of physicists who are recounted in this book who have tried to explain these criticisms of Boehm and others, and those are recounted here. But of course, Boehm and others have responded to those responses, and so it goes on. But it's the multiverse is probably in cosmology, it's probably more well accepted. It's less what we might call fraught with controversy than the parallel universes. And it doesn't have the same kinds of intrinsic problems. It has fine-tuning problems, but it doesn't have intrinsic physical problems. There are other kinds of difficulties with it, but that would require boring you to tears. So, but maybe we can talk about it at the reception.
First of all, I will preface my question by the fact that I knew Georges Lemaître personally. Oh. I took two courses from him at the Catholic University of Louvain. And one question or one item that was brought up by the second speaker was Pope Pius XII, who was very, very happy about Lemaître's proof that there could have been a unique instant, a day without yesterday, as Lemaître himself put it. But then Lemaître wrote to the Pope, mm-hmm. and said, I'm sorry, Your Highness, or Your Holiness, mm-hmm. You cannot use a physical explanation to prop up religion, which it seems to me is exactly what you have done. And the Pope wisely replied, I'm sorry, I made a mistake, I won't do it again.
No, actually, this, has come up, is this propping up a religious explanation, or is it probabilistic logical conclusion that can be drawn from three different data sets? Obviously, whenever a person in a Roman collar speaks about these things, it looks very much like you're propping up, a religious conclusion. But, Alan Guth and Alexander Vilenkin and Arvin Borda, have no particular religious axe to grind. Fred Hoyle certainly had no religious axe to grind. He was an atheist, as many of you know, for 45 years, and was kind of the atheistic gadfly of the religious community. Why did they move toward, this kind of, conclusion? Again, you're dealing with a probabilistic conclusion. You're dealing with something that's fraught with caveats, where you can't have, as it were, a proof. By the way, I didn't choose this title for my book, right? Publisher specialty, For all intents and purposes, they like to make things exciting. But the idea, behind probabilistic evidence from physical conclusions is not at all foreign to many physicists who have no particular religious disposition at all. I suppose Arvind Borda may be a Hindu, I'm not sure. I think maybe Alan Guth may be a Jewish. I'm not sure. They've never come out with any particular religious flavor. So what is their thinking? Why are they doing this? They actually think it is the logical conclusion to physical evidence, which does seem to suggest an absolute beginning to physical reality if you can pull it back far enough. In the Borda, Vilenkin, and Guth theorem, all of the three authors all admitted that the
beginning of our universe may not be the beginning of physical reality, right? Could be a transformation to a new physics, like quantum cosmological universe. But that quantum cosmological universe, in turn, it would have to have a beginning, because its average Hubble expansion would have to be greater than zero. And then maybe there was a multiverse prior to that. But that, too, would have to have a beginning, because its average Hubble expansion would have to be greater than zero. And for that reason, there is the thinking out there that there is kind of, you know, you're getting to the point of an absolute beginning, which cosmologists, and this is Alexander Vilenkin's words, have to resign themselves to looking at. You just can't use the excuse, oh, it's religious, I'm a scientist, I can't use it. You do have to acknowledge when probabilistically you may have a point at which you're approaching an absolute beginning. And when it combines up with other data sets, you may actually find a point where it might be more reasonable and responsible to at least, not appeal to God, but appeal to some sort of transcendent causative force outside of universal and multiversal space-time asymmetry. And that could be more reasonable and responsible than a purely naturalistic one, even a multiverse one, you know, that seems elegant. By the way, none of them really do without huge amounts of fine-tuning. But that's where it stands. So I don't think I'm trying to prop up a religious belief so much as, well, what's the evidence? Where's science leading? I'm not saying it follows by necessity. I'm simply saying there seems to be probabilistic probative force, to put it in the words of Alexander Vilenkin, and that probabilistic probative force, well, it's very interesting, and it may have consequences, not only for the way we view the universe, but for us personally. So that's what, you know, we shouldn't shun it, simply because it reaches the limits of space-time geometry.